So my name is Vedang, as she has already told you. I'm going to talk today about growing a Clojure company. I'm going to take you through our experience with HelpShift. This is kind of a managerial talk. I'll try my best not to put you guys to sleep. I'll also move a little bit fast because I have quite a few slides to cover. So please ask me to slow down if you think that I'm like going too fast. Please like boo me or something if you're going to sleep or whatever, right? Okay. So my intuition is that the problems and solutions that I'll outline are pretty much what universal. They are applicable to any language, any company. But this is just our discovery of them along the way. Right off the bat, I want to say that this is an opinionated talk. I hope you will find it useful, but please assume an implicit in my opinion wherever possible. And finally, before getting into the talk, I just want to say that my talk today is the result of the work of all of the HelpShift engineering team. I love working with these guys. Every day I get to learn something new. Okay, so you decide to start a Clojure company, right? You're the CTO, you have convinced your other founders or investors that Clojure is the language that you want to go with. Meet me later if you want to build a business case for Clojure. And you start your hiring journey, right? At this point in time, you can only lean on your network. These initial engineers that you hire are people you're entering a long-term committed relationship with. So they have to be people that you already know and trust. If you belong to the Clojure community, you have a slight advantage here. Most Clojure programmers have a ton of overall programming experience. This is something that you want in your initial engineers. You want them to be opinionated. You want them to be experienced. This data comes from the State of Clojure Survey 2019. Okay, so this is you right now, small set of people building away your MVP. Things are really, really looking up. You're having a lot of fun. How are you doing with Clojure itself? You're doing great. You know that you're able to rapidly build your MVP because of the REPL. You know that because Clojure runs on top of the JVM, you're going to get pretty decent performance. You know how you're going to be able to deploy your system. You know how you're going to be able to monitor it. If there is something that you don't find in Clojure, you're going to be able to drop down to the Java library. It's a pretty superb language to get stuff done in, actually, especially when you're a very, very small team. All the while, you're still going to look out for people to join, right? So you're still leaning on your own network, but now you also get to lean on the network of people who are part of your team already, right? Along with that, there will be these curious people who are like so plugged into the software development world and so excited to learn. They're willing to take a risk on you. So they are going to approach you to say, hey, can I work with you? So inbounds and referrals are people who are going to be amazing for you. You should absolutely make every effort to have them join you. So as we go through this talk, I'm going to have like these slides just to kind of make it a little bit more interesting and not me be speaking at you. This is kind of what your team will soon look like over maybe the first year or first 2 years of your journey. This was where I entered HelpShift story 10 years ago. We were called Infinitely Beta at the time. And it was great. It was a very, very small team. My experience with Clojure was that I absolutely loved it. It was the first time I felt that I was actually thinking about the problem that I wanted to solve instead of fighting with syntax to get something done. We didn't have anything like onboarding or whatever of that sort, right? There was no formal thing called onboarding at that time. But how did I learn Clojure? I learned Clojure because our CTO at the time, BG, took complete responsibility of teaching us Clojure and showing us why Clojure is a magical language. As I look back now, that was a big reason why our team took off and why we were able to build so many features quickly. At that point in time, we didn't really have any, oh, we need this to be a thing, or we need to be like teaching is an important thing or whatever, right? But in hindsight, this was the thing that was like really, really important. I also want to come back to language for a bit. As a team, what was our experience using Clojure, right? It was incredible. We were a small set of people who were like working together around one table. Clojure would just get out of our way, let us do what we wanted to do. Communication was not a problem. Alignment was not a problem. We were just trying to keep the company alive, right? So those managerial things had not come up yet. Speed of getting things done in Clojure was a huge advantage. The rapid feedback loop meant that, you know, I was able to enter what people called flow state, right? Which is you go into the zone, and then 8 hours later, you come out and find that the entire feature is done. For me, my personal experience has been that it has been much easier for me to get into the zone when programming in Clojure than with any other language that I've tried before or after. Oops, let's go back there. Okay. Something that people don't generally talk about is this ability to connect to production servers, live production servers, and change code instantly. This was just mind-blowing for me that it was possible to do something like this. Once we had our CEO, AT, call us from the United States when we were packing up and going out for dinner. He was giving a demo to a customer and something was broken in production. We kept him on the phone, connected to the production servers, asked him to rerun the actions, diagnose the problem, patch the problem, and then went to dinner. And all of that was like in 15 minutes. It was like, that was seriously impressive. It was amazing that we could do things at that speed. Here is a picture of me from that time. We had 8 production servers at that time. I used to be connected to all of them all the time. So yeah, at this point in time, things were like really, really good. We had raised 1 round of funding. We had real customers. We had a product that we cared deeply about. After experimenting with a few ideas, we suddenly found product market fit with HelpShift, which is the name of our company now. The number of our customers grew, and with that, like the demand to build more features also grew. So yeah, so we were still looking somewhat like this, but now like we were wanting to go somewhere here, right? So we were looking to hire. This was also the problem, the place where I would say the first problem started cropping up, and mostly because this was the first time we had the bandwidth to do multiple different things in parallel, right? So there were like multiple unconnected stuff going on, and it would interact with each other in ways that we did not anticipate. So at this stage, we bought code review and other things like that into picture. We started using something called Gerrit for code review, and we continue using it today. It is an absolutely amazing tool. Okay. So this is where, this is the problem, right? Like we wanted to hire people, and there are no people. So you can call your recruiters up and say, hey, give me Clojure engineers, and there's going to be nobody, right? So Abhinash, our CEO, was like, hey, did we do the right thing? Like, there are so many Ruby and Python developers. Why are we going with this language? So at this point in time, we decided that we had chosen a good stack. We just need to sell it. Because we and you, everyone in this room, because we have selected a niche tech stack, there will always be curious people who want to learn, right? So you just have to put yourself in front of them, and then when they join your company, you have to make them successful. So we went to colleges, right? We hired excellent people from colleges, and these people joined our ventures happily. Also, because we were hiring people from colleges, the point of training, teaching, that really became important, right? Onboarding went from being something that was like considered okay, we need to like do something about it, to becoming critical. We had to learn, the senior engineers in the team had to learn, that onboarding was our job. Like it was a job thing. It was not something that we just did because we enjoyed doing it. We tried different ways of doing onboarding. I'm not going to go into all of the ways because we are short on time. But what we do today, which I have found is the best thing so far, is that we write everything down and we make chapters that people can follow along, right? So when somebody joins the team, there is a mentor that is assigned to this person, and the mentor and the mentee can then work through these chapters at their own pace. Chapters need to address very, very specific things, and they need to be time bound, right? So some examples of chapters can be, say, language training, of course, how to be productive, how to use the tools within the company, understanding the product, understanding the culture. All these things are chapters. Having them be time-bound gives a sense of urgency and a sense of achievement to the mentee when he's working through the chapter. Finally, if there are some tests, then the mentee can actually reinforce their learning and again feel like they're doing something, they're contributing. Here is an example from our onboarding chapter to show you what this looks like. I highlighted the test knowledge part just to show you that, and you can see my drawing skills are terrible. So, yeah. All right. How are we doing with the language at this point in time? Okay. So you can see this is going to be like a repeating theme in the talk. We are going to talk about onboarding, hiring, language, right? Okay. At this point in time, let's cover the bad parts first. This was where we stopped hot patching. There was just too many production servers. It was not possible to log into 50 different REPLs and hot patch code. It was just not going to work. There was also the chance that we would make catastrophic mistakes in production. And I mean, this was not chance, it has happened, right? So we found ourselves that we were ending up announcing that, hey, I have hot patched some code, please do not restart this server, or please wait for me to create the tag and push this out. And at that point, we were like, okay, this is not, like, this is too much effort. We need to stop doing this. And I really, really feel bad about this. Like, I really miss the ability to just hot patch in production. It was incredible. Have you come across this yet in your own code or when you are working in your teams? So this was the thing that we were starting to see. Like, we were writing code really, really fast in small teams. We had tight deadlines always, right? So your code was going to end up looking like this. Hey, don't touch this part. I have no idea what is happening here. Or I've been reading this code for a long, long time. I still don't know what it does. I have a really nice macro story out here, but I won't go into that because we just covered that topic right now. So this was where we decided we needed to establish some conventions on how we are going to write the code. So what did we want? We wanted a system that was simple and straightforward, right? We were thinking about all the code that we had written so far. We were thinking about all the code that we are going to write. Fred Brooks in the Mythical Man Month has explained the properties of a good system in this one paragraph here, in one page, right? I know you're not going to be able to read this because it's like, I don't know if it's visible or not, but let me just paraphrase this. What he says is, for a system to be simple and straightforward, every part must reflect the same philosophies. Every part must use the same techniques in syntax. Every part must use the same notions in semantics, right? How does this translate to code? Your code should follow the same style everywhere. Your code should be idiomatic, right? What does these two things, what do they mean? They mean that if I look at a piece of code, I should not be able to tell who has written it by looking at the piece of code, right? All the company-wide code should look the same. Our code should combine together in known patterns, right? So it should be very, very easy for us to make pipelines or whatever. It should be a known thing, and you should be able to know exactly what you have to do with it. So we then sat down to figure out how we can achieve these goals, right? We needed to build some workflows to be able to get to this point. So a quick show of hands, I want to know how many people here use tooling to tell them whether the code that they have written is idiomatic or not, right? Yeah, so it's a very, very small number, guys. I was hoping everyone will put their hand up. Like, this exercise was not to make you go to sleep, basically, that's all. So yeah, Qibit allows you to do idiomatic code usage, right? How many people here do automatic formatting, which means that as soon as you save the code, the formatting is fixed, right? CLJ style does that. How many people here use a linter while they're writing code, so that they know whether things are right or wrong, right? So yeah, these things exist in the Clojure universe. I just don't think everybody uses them well enough. So like Bojo said, the future is here, it's just not evenly distributed or whatever. So yeah. So please use these tools. They give you distraction-free feedback as you are working, and it ends up improving the quality of the code that you write. Okay, so Clojure is a very, very powerful language, right? I don't want to like go into how it is powerful, why it is powerful. We had, again, a session on macros just before this one, right? This is one of the main reasons why it is such a productivity multiplying thing to use Clojure. Just look at these libraries. Like, I know you guys have heard of these libraries, and probably many of you use these libraries, but look inside these libraries sometime. That code is crazy, right? So these libraries teach us a really, really important lesson on how to use Clojure's incredible power. First part, keep the magic bits to a minimum and wrap them in a small core. Right? Design a simple, well-documented API that is easy and intuitive to use, and hide all of the magic stuff behind this. 90% of the people should not even have to ever see this stuff. Okay. Use the powerful things that the language gives you, like macros or dev type or whatever new stuff is coming out, dev spec. Use them carefully and only where you absolutely need them. Clojure provides incredible testing facilities. Use them to write decent tests around this complicated stuff so that you will know when you make a mistake in the future. So these were the things that we were trying to get into the system, right? Just for a minute, let's go back to hiring. Because, okay, we had, like, we were growing, we were learning along the way, we had hired people out of college, but we were now at a scale where we also wanted to hire people who had previous experience. And hiring senior engineers is really hard in Clojure. Mainly because there are not so many senior engineers, right? Like, in general, there are not so many senior engineers, any language you take. People like me move into management. So we have never ever hired a single person so far who already knew Clojure before joining the company. We have hired some people who had heard of the language, and that was great, like even that was amazing, but most people had never used it in production. There was also the problem that people didn't really want to change their stack, even if they thought that they did. Right? I would like to get into, like, I would have liked to get into the details of how we actually do hiring, the absolute process of hiring at Helpshift, but I'm going to skip that in the interest of time. I already have like 50 more slides to go through. But this is the one thing that we really, really stress on, which is that ensure that the person is ready to learn Clojure. Right? So what we do is we give each person a very, very small Clojure project, a zip file containing a line engine project, which has three functions stubbed. Right? We give them exact instructions on how to run this code on their machine. We give them all of the material that is necessary to fill these stub functions in. Right? This material needs like 30 minutes of reading time, not more than that. We explain to the candidate that this project is given to them to give them a taste of the language, to give them an understanding of what the language will feel like. Right? Then we ask the person to fill the code and give it back to us. And this has proved to be a great filter for us. Many people just drop out at this stage. Now, even when people buy into the fact that they want to learn Clojure, we have seen senior people become disheartened after they join the company. The main reason for that is that unlearning mutability takes time. It's very, very hard to like change the way that you think, and functional programming forces you to think in a different way. Also, senior engineers really want to like create impact immediately. They are used to being people who are seen as big change makers, and it's very hard for them to realize that it's going to take them time to learn new things. Our job then is to help these people see the bigger picture and to give them a sense that they are making progress. So how do you do that? Right. Do you guys remember the first time that you actually understood how reduce works? Or maybe used potentially infinite sequences lazily, right? I remember my first time with these two things, and I remember how like my mind was completely blown. I was like, wow, this is amazing, right? So design exercises so that the engineers that join your company can experience this, these aha moments, right? With every exercise, build up towards a larger goal so that engineers can experience how these components combine together, right? Again, I want to like just call back to the talk previous to this one, where he was building up over like very, very small pieces. Arvind was showing us how macros can become more and more complicated. That's an excellent chapter to have in training. One other great way that we have found is ask the new person to program that assignment in their favorite language and then sit with them and rewrite it in Clojure. Right? This is an absolutely superb way of showcasing the strengths and weaknesses of Clojure, as well as learning from the new team member. And when they get it right, it's amazing. That sense of, oh, okay, this is the reason why this is why we use this language. This is the reason why we do things in this way. Think back on why you love Clojure, right? Why do I love Clojure? There are so many reasons. I can talk about it for a long time. These are some things that I've heard from engineers once they've joined the company, right? The ability to test everything on the REPL. This is not common. Not many languages have this. We tend to take this for granted, right? And this is incredible. The ability to write small functions that do just one thing and then chain those small functions together to build something more complicated. Again, Clojure just makes it possible to do these things. And it's not really something that is that trivially simple in other languages. For me, this flow of data is a much, much easier way of thinking about programming than interaction via objects, right? So just having a piece of data which flows through multiple functions is just amazing. One aside out here, just like a small slide on QA. We started building a backend quality assurance team this year in Helpshift. Right? How did we go for so long without a backend QA team? So these properties of Clojure that I just specified on the previous slide was a huge reason for that. It was just that it was easier to test the code that we were writing, and it was easier to have those things just work. And of course, honestly, we should have started a QA team maybe a year or two ago, right? We are late at it, and we are doing it now because we see the problems that we are facing, right? But the problems that we are facing are not, so they are because of having multiple different services built by multiple different teams, which are loosely coupled together. And what is the job that our QA team is going to do? They are going to ensure that these contracts that these services require are enforced, right? So they are going to build automated systems testing. Quality is not like one team's job, it's everybody's job. And that's like, we should not be having QA teams for doing feature testing, we should be having QA teams for doing systems, performance, those kind of things. Okay, back to the onboarding bit, right? One more thing that we can do to give senior engineers a sense of progress is to enable people to push to production early, right? The idea is that give them meaningful milestones so that they feel that they are contributing to the team and not just getting paid for doing nothing. And also give them a full taste of the process that is involved in going to production. They need to know what it means to commit code, get it reviewed, create all the tickets that are necessary, create the whatever else is required, you know, do the documentation, testing, etc. Okay, what is required for this? In order to be able to push to production, you need to have a curated, discoverable backlog of work. Right? This is the first requirement. This backlog needs to be sorted according to the learning level of the engineer and the module that they are working on. Ideally, this module should be the same module that their mentor is also working on, and that helps with fast feedback and unblocking. Architecture documentation, another amazing resource for new team members to join into, to tap into, right? This helps them understand how the system was designed, what are the trade-offs, what are the reasons for the trade-offs. And even if they don't understand the language, they can jump into conversations and feel like, and actually not feel like, that's wrong. They jump into conversations and contribute. Okay. Let's come back to this slide for a bit. What does your team look like? So this is what we were looking like before this whole discussion got underway. Now we are actually like becoming big. So I have some more points on language, but before that, I want to talk about processes at this point in time, which is completely unrelated to Clojure, I know, but I needed to get this out. This is on my agenda. At this point in time, processes will make or break your team, your company, right? What is the point of these processes? Make it possible to take decisions objectively and don't depend on like one person's judgment. Great example, code reviews, right? How many people have a well-defined process to do code review? Show of hands, guys. Yeah, okay, everyone is awake and still paying attention, right? Your process should clearly outline what is good and bad, right? When you're writing code, what does a good commit message look like? Can this commit actually be merged in? Does it have all the criteria that is required? What this does when you have all of this written down is it removes ego from the process. So anyone can give anyone else a -2 do not merge rating without feeling scared or without feeling what this person will think like. Our code review processes were so stringent that one of my colleagues, Kapil, if he's here somewhere, created a short movie celebrating his +2 approved for merge commit when he got it. Operations review. This helps you decide whether something should go to production or not, right? Are you production ready? So having this document helps engineers think through capacity planning, monitoring, alerting, other gotchas that are there in supporting service in production. Following this process ensures that engineers are not caught by last-minute surprises. Architecture review is similar to operations review, but for design practices. This process gathers company-wide knowledge that is gained from hard experience about what works, what does not work when you're designing systems, right? So when you are filling out this document, you have to answer questions like, where do you capture application state? How do you achieve graceful degradation? How do you uphold the SLOs that you have agreed upon? Being told that your feature cannot ship to production, right, because you did not think about these things, is really, really hard. I still remember the first time that it had happened to me. We had some theoretical scenario about how my system could fail. And I argued that it was never going to happen, or it would take some time to happen at least. So why delay the release? Let's go to production, and I'll fix it in the next few days that I have, right? I forced everyone to go to release, went home, slept, was woken up in the night. The system had failed exactly the same way that we had predicted it would fail in review. Right. So these things, they really matter. One final thing in managerial mumbo jumbo is change management, right? How many people here have a communication process about what is shipping when? Right? Great, good. Change management helps avoid surprises, like two teams planning to change the DB schema or to change make a change in the same table without talking to each other. Right? This is an extremely powerful way to streamline releases and to ensure that all stakeholders are actually ready. Of course, the example that I gave, two teams changing the DB schema in the same table without talking to each other, that's exactly what happened at Helpshift. That's why we started with this. OK, so that brings me to the end of the processes thing, which according to me is like the most critical part of this talk, but I'm sure people may have glazed out during it. Good processes are critical for success, like I have already mentioned. Emphasis here on good is by design, right? You need to continually revisit your processes. As your teams grow, as your company scales, your old processes will become bad, and you will need new processes. So throw out the ones that don't work, keep the ones that are working, start making new processes where you need them. OK, finally, back to language. And we'll just quickly rush through these things because I'm already ahead of time, I think. OK. The Clojure community ecosystem is building superb stuff into the core language. And there are superb libraries that are coming out every year, every month, whatever. Right? So how do we keep benefiting from this? How do we ensure that we do not fall back? Right. This is the job of our senior engineers and our architects. They should be exploring new and powerful features of Clojure in a deliberate manner. When they test this, when they build POCs, they need to document this carefully. What are the pros and cons of this construct? What is really important? How to use this feature, when to use this feature, and the most important is when not to use this feature, which is basically when you have a hammer, everything looks like a nail, right? So you learn something new and you start doing that everywhere. That's really important to avoid. Once you have all of this stuff written down, we generally present it to the team, and then we can start using it in production as the knowledge gets to everyone. I remember when we used Core Async for the first time, right? Like when Core Async came out, we had multiple lightning talks trying to understand what this library was and why people were freaking out about how cool it was, right? And when I learned the kind of indirection that it would let me do, that was another aha moment for me. Today, Core.Async usage in Helpshift is like, we don't even like think about it. We are just like, oh yeah, why don't you use a channel there? Nobody thinks, oh, this is a cool thing. That's because we are now aware of the patterns. I mean, I wish people thought it is a cool thing. It is. But we are aware of the patterns and how they should be used. All right. So when we were less than 10 engineers, whenever we created a new repository, we would copy all the utility code from an existing repository into it. Right? And that was it. We didn't think twice about it. things were moving fast, and these are the things you do when you're a small team, right? But there is a huge advantage in pulling all of this stuff out into common libraries and ensuring that everybody is doing exactly the same thing in exactly the same way. For example, if you choose logging, what can you do when everybody is logging in exactly the same format from everywhere? You can create common logging infrastructure, right? You can ensure that all your services, all the logs are streaming into one place, and then you have something like Kibana, which is sitting on top of it, where you can look at those logs. When we first went ahead with this, when we first completed this project and had Kibana, it was a huge boost to the kind of debugging that we could do, just to see how a request is flowing through different services and have all of those logs in one place to investigate. Just like logging, if you're going down this path, some other easy things that you can target are monitoring, settings, configuration, auditing, right? These are kind of like obvious things that we can pull out and make into common libraries that can be used from everywhere in the same way. OK. So your company-wide common pattern libraries are now in place, right? So everybody is using these specific things in the same way. What is the next step? Make a template. Anytime you're starting a new project, that new project should have the same layout and have all the same libraries that you require, all filled in, all the base code created, so that all you have to do is just go in there and write the business logic that you want. Just about to wrap up. Okay. So Luminous is a way that you can do this in Clojure. If you're thinking, is this boilerplate? This is, but I think of this as boilerplate for production, which is very, very different than boilerplate when you're starting a project, right? This is what a new project looks like when you create it in Luminous. I don't think you can see it, but I'll try to explain what it is doing. In this particular case, we have said create a new project, which is a service which uses Jetty and MongoDB. And Luminous has created the entire directory structure, has filled in all of the, has created all the files that you need, filled in all the stub code where you need it. And all you have to do now is go and modify the places, the few places, and add your business logic in. Right. What is the benefit of doing something like this? A standard layout, it really, really helps. Reviewers can then like just review the exact thing that they need to review and safely ignore everything else. This is my crude attempt at making that like clear via a diagram. That actual file is quite big, but you only need to review the small part that has been zoomed in. Everything else is just boilerplate that you can ignore. Okay, so I am at the end of my slides after having rushed through it. In closing, we looked at our journey at Helpshift along three main axes, which are hiring, onboarding, and what the language gave us at every point. Okay, here you go. I forgot to do that. So in the preparation of this talk, I actually ended up with far more slides that I had to cut out. I love to talk about this stuff. If you have any questions or if you want clarification on certain things, please find me. I'll be very, very happy to answer your questions or to learn something new from you guys. Thanks. Any questions? Yes, I'm done.